It's fitting that I get to follow an economist, and a distinguished one at that. We've heard many times that America confronts three interrelated crises: an economic crisis, a climate crisis, an energy security crisis. My message today is that there's a fourth, and that's a competitiveness crisis. It's a looming crisis in our worldwide standing in the next great global industry, which I believe is green technology. It was 50 years ago that America won the space race with the Soviet Union, and I suggest that today we're in an Earth race for the future of the planet, in an energy race for the future of America's standing in the world. Now, I was inducted into the Academy yesterday. When I received word of that announcement, I was quite sure they'd made a mistake, because I'm not a distinguished thinker or a scientist or an artist or performer. In fact, I'm an engineer and a partner at the venture capital firm of Kleiner Perkins. We work for the country's great colleges and universities. We get funds from their endowments. And then we invest those monies in the risky plans of unproven entrepreneurs who would never qualify for a bank loan. We're not financial engineers. As some would say, we're investing in sub-subprime opportunities. But it turns out these entrepreneurs end up building real businesses with lots of jobs. And in the case of my partnership, since the mid-70s, over 500 companies and 400,000 U.S. jobs. The likes of Genentech that pioneered a whole new industry, or Google, which changed the way we search, and many, many more. So my perspective on this is from that of the entrepreneurs and the innovators. How far behind are we then in this energy race? Did you know that the United States, America, is now home to only two of the top 10 solar photovoltaic producers worldwide, and only one of the top 10 wind providers worldwide, and only one of the top 10 advanced battery makers worldwide? Let me repeat that. Only four out of the top 30 companies worldwide in these green technologies is headquartered in the U.S. Yet we use a lot of these products, and we use a lot of energy. All this translates into our country at this point in the race being in a losing position for the next great global industry. And I suggest that should worry all of us a lot. To lose our advantage, as one of the other speakers said, in technologies that were invented and pioneered here, is going to cost us very dearly if we do not reverse it. So who's on track to win this race? China. Do you believe that? China's commitment to green technologies is staggering. I've got three quick facts for you. Number one, China is on track to deploy 120 gigawatts of wind by 2020. That's more than four times the cumulative U.S. wind deployment over the past 30 years. It's the equivalent of 250 coal-fired power plants. Two, China is investing in its energy stimulus at a scale that is six times the U.S. investment from our stimulus package. And three, they are deploying high-speed rail at a pace and scale that's almost hard to imagine. How can we possibly catch up? Well, I think we can, but it's only going to be through the power of good old homegrown American entrepreneurs and innovation and the right policies and the power of private capital markets. There's more money that flows through private markets in a day than all the governments of the world in a year. And one other thing that I've learned along the way is to never underestimate the power of entrepreneurs. As they say, entrepreneurs do more than anyone thinks possible with less than anyone thinks possible. And if time permitted, I'd love to tell you the stories of three or four entrepreneurs that we've backed who are doing really disruptive, aggressive projects that will have a stunning effect if they work. I like to say that we don't knowingly invest in research and development. We've accidentally done that a few times. It's our aim to accelerate the commercialization of these technologies. But I want to turn to a final point. All the work that these entrepreneurs are doing is going to fail unless we get one thing really right. and the time I spent in Washington, D.C. recently, including a couple days last week, was to advocate comprehensive, forward-looking energy and climate change legislation now. And I commend to you an op-ed piece that Senator Kerry wrote together with Richard Shelby, Democrat and Republican, in today's New York Times newspaper. There would be four components of this legislation that are just key. The first, as was said earlier, is we've got to put a price on carbon. When we put a price on carbon, that's going to unleash the investment of all those private capital markets, regardless of what the policies are in the government. And we need that capital. We need that signal. We need the equivalent of what the Netscape initial public offering was for the world's internet entrepreneurs. You put a price on carbon, that's the equivalent of Sputnik over our heads 50 years ago. It will rally entrepreneurs, innovators, investors, policymakers, and business leaders all to get about this very important business. Second important point of the policy we need is to get the rules and regulations for our utilities right to drive efficiency, drive renewable portfolio investments, and to get a national unified smart grid. The third thing that we need is efficiency standards. America should have the highest, most fuel-efficient cars and the cleanest, most effective buildings in the world. And the only way to get there is going to be through standards and incentives. And then fourth, I feel passionately we must get serious about funding R&D at scale. R&D, where that second D is deployment. I think last year the federal investments in energy research were about $1.8 billion out of a $1 trillion component of our economy. This is shameful. It might even be criminal. So we know these kinds of policies can work. We know innovation can work. It's working in other countries around the world. All you have to do is look to Denmark, which is a state with a smaller country, with a smaller population than Missouri or Tennessee or Michigan. In 1970, they put in place policies to encourage a low-carbon, independent energy future. It started their wind industry with a local market, and today a third of all windmills in the world come from Denmark. Their technology exports last year were $10 billion, and their unemployment rate was under 3%. In closing, I'd like to compare this opportunity for energy to the internet. Think of this. 15 years ago, just a decade and a half, there was no web browser. This whole idea of point and click that we take for granted, it wasn't there. There was no internet at our fingertips, no e-commerce, no search engines, and now it's transformed our lives. Imagine a world where Microsoft was a German company, Apple was Japanese, and Google, eBay, and Yahoo were all Chinese-headquartered companies, and only Amazon was American. That's the path that we're on right now with respect to our nation's prosperity and worldwide leadership if we don't address this fourth competitiveness crisis. The internet today, created in 15 years, is a trillion-dollar economy which 1.2 billion people around the world access. Energy is a $6 trillion economy with 4 billion users of electricity around the world, and usage is doubling every 20 or so years. I'd like to say this is the mother of all markets. It is the largest economic opportunity of the 21st century, and to lead in this future, we need the right policies, we need the right incentives, we need the right kind of innovation. So our competitors around the world have woken up. We need to do the same with the kind of forward-looking, comprehensive climate and energy legislation I described, or else we're going to be buying our future from them. Thanks.